So we're behind 227 Front Street East, downtown Toronto, and we're going to be exploring the only Dead Drops location that is known to be in Toronto at this time. Dead Drops were started by the Aaron Barthold guy. He was from Berlin originally, and he started the Dead Drop program in October 2010. It is an anonymous, peer-to-peer, file-sharing program that is open to the public, and you can put anything you want on it. The only one that is in Toronto is right here beside this downspout on the side of this building. So USB drives are embedded into the walls anonymously. You can put them anywhere you want, and anyone can do them. Here. On this USB itself, there will always be the initial text. Readme text. Yeah. There's a readme text that explains what Dead Drops are and who does them, and the website that you can go to find more Dead Drops. Any type of media you can put on it. There's music, there's photos, there's a bread recipe, there's
how-to.
There's some how-to documents, and there's also fictional drugs that are in films.
Lots of pictures.
There's tons of pictures of random things. People, places, things, objects, people's favorite objects, places people have gone, personal photography that people have taken. It's just awesome.
A flash mob is an event where a large group of people show up at the same place and time to perform an unusual act for a period of time and then disperse. They catch people's attention and are excellent tools to make a statement about a social or political issue. Sometimes it can even be something ironic to mock the consumer society we live in. Unfortunately, the popularity of flash mobs allow the companies within the consumer society to perform flash mobs as an advertising tool. Advertising is not the original purpose of flash mobs, and they've changed flash mobs from being a tool to make important criticism about our society to a shiny and fun song and dance to catch the eye of consumers. Flash mobs that have taken place in Toronto include a giant pillow fight in Dundas Square, an MP3 experiment, Free Hug Day, and the YMCA dance. As disruptive and traffic-stopping as flash mobs can be, they bring strangers together to create a strong collaborative message, which we think is what flash mobs are really about.
Vandalism, man, it's painting, it's drawing, sketchings, any type of visual image posted on something that probably doesn't belong there. As you can see, we're down in Toronto, just off Jarvis, down this way, right here on this old building, we're just standing. We got tons of graffiti. Obviously, these guys knew what they were doing because they went on a black background. But if we look over here, we can see in front of the garage. Now, probably this is done at night, so this is pretty impressive and done by streetlights. Also, it's a huge main hub because of the Loblaws. So anyone who actually did this is like amazing.
Many graffiti artists consider their art form as like pure art, such as what you see here. But there's also a lot of other uses. It can be used to tag gang areas, and it can also be used as kind of like an advertising marketing tool.
These headphones were done by a graffiti artist and made it big and skull handy.
I can't remember his name, but it's pretty badass as you can see. So people will go out on the streets and actually scout for graffiti artists to use in mainstream product.
One problem this can cause is that oftentimes it's done on private property, and for business owners that own that type of property, they often get really offended, aggravated by it. They have to clean it off or find a way to cover it up, which is pretty difficult.
If you're going to do something illegal, at least do it right. This is pretty badass. This is like, I don't even call this graffiti, I call this street art. It's like, street art. It makes it cooler. They took some boring palette and made it cool.
The guy's a gremlin! What?
They're survivors!
Oh my!